Welcome to People Doing Good for Others, where we praise and honor and celebrate those who are truly making significant contributions in our communities. We're grateful for the sponsorship of Wilkes Communications, River Street Productions, and 100.9 WIFM for this opportunity, and we're so happy that you choose to be with us today. My featured guest is Brooke Bentley. She's from this community. Her family's been here for significant contributions. She's a freshman at the University of North Carolina. She's a graduate of Wilkes Central High School, a member of the 2015 State Championship Girls Basketball. And we're just so honored to have her with us this morning. And thank you for being here, Ms. Brooke Bentley. And I think family would be a good place for us to start. So just talk about your mom and dad and your brother and where you live and just go from there.
Well, like you said, my parents have been in Wilkes County forever and ever. My dad graduated from Wilkes Central also, and my mom graduated from North Wilkes. And my dad's a lawyer in the community. He's still here practicing law. And my mom's a teacher at Wilkes Central High School. And I actually had her as one of my teachers, which is pretty cool. But between the two of them, basically, if we go out in public, we know everyone because mom's either taught them or dad's helped them with legal advice or something. And my younger brother's a sophomore at Wilkes Central High School, so he's still coming up behind me. I want him to go to Carolina, but I want him to come with me to school, but we'll see.
So we have their names. Let's make sure we understand that.
My dad is Lee Bentley, and my mom's Ginger Bentley, and my little brother's name is Jake.
Okay. So where do you live?
I live in Wilkes County still. I live over near the country club in Wilkes County.
Okay.
So.
All right. So that's a nice way for us to get started. Talk about the that state championship basketball team, and I was right there, and I shall always treasure looking across the court and seeing you and Coach Wall there together at the end. I'm sure that's a moment that most of us never have that moment. So tell us about Wilkes Central High School.
Oh, I loved Wilkes Central, and I wouldn't change where I went to high school, who I played basketball with, who my coach was for anything. I really just bleed green and gold, true and true. And I honestly think that if it weren't for Coach Wall, we definitely wouldn't have won that state championship because he pushed us harder than any coach I've ever played for. And he was just, well, he was a great coach, but also he's a great person. So that's just an added bonus for us because I learned so much from him on the court, but also just as a person, I learned so much from him, which was really, really neat.
Brooke Bentley, tell us, we're talking about Scott Wall, mm-hmm. the basketball coach, and he was, I think he was a great athlete at Wilkes Central also, is that right?
Yeah, I think he played basketball, soccer, and baseball, but he did play baseball at Appalachian.
Right.
And I know his basketball jersey's hanging up on the wall outside the gym,
really?
Which is really neat. It's crazy to be like playing for a coach and then walk outside and his jersey's right there. It's a little bit intimidating, but.
Share the experience prior to your ninth grade class and that you would be on the team. Tell us about that story.
Well, I came into my freshman year of high school and I was like, well, I know I want to play basketball. And I remember in eighth grade going to NC State to watch Paige and Haley and Katie Ryder's team play in the state championship. And I was sitting there right behind the bench and saw them lose. And I was like, no. And I just, from that moment, I was like, man, this is something that I want to do. Like, I want to win a state championship. This is so cool. Like, I want to do this. But I came in my freshman year and I was like, I'm not going to make varsity. Like, I'll just stay on JV for 2 years and then I'll, you know, come up and maybe we'll win a state championship then. And so we were never told after tryouts who made varsity and who made JV. We just all kept practicing together kind of thing. And then I guess like a week before our first game in the newspaper, they had in the Journal Patriot, they had the article about like this is the team for the year, and my name was in it, and I was like, wait, I'm on varsity? I was like, wow. But Coach Wall didn't tell us this. And so I was like, wow, I'm on varsity, and I didn't know it, and Coach Wall didn't tell me. And so then we get around to the first game, and we were playing Surrey Central, and they're pretty good. I remember this vividly. And we come in the locker room, and Coach Wall wrote the starters on the board, and my name was up there, and I was like, what do I do? I was like, I can't start. What are you talking about? I'm a freshman.
Oh, my goodness.
This is crazy. And so I was sitting there on the bench, and they were like, a 5'7 freshman. At the time, I'm like 5'4", and I was like, I'll take it. So I just ran out there, and it was probably one of the scariest moments besides the state championship of basketball that I've played. And I was like, oh, my goodness, how am I going to do this? But it was really fun, and it was just great.
Great. So, during the season, did you have a, where did you get, was it a team that just found itself during the year, just got better and better and better?
Definitely.
Tell us about that.
Definitely. We had all, so we'd only lost from my freshman year, we lost one person my freshman year. And then my sophomore year, we lost one more person. So we'd virtually played together for 3 years my junior year. So it was our third year all playing together. So we were like, we have to make this happen. We loved our seniors. We had Lakin Blackburn and Amber Godfrey and Megan McCumber were our seniors. And so we were like, we have to do this for our seniors. Like, we have to play hard. We have to win. We have to keep winning. And I think, like, from the beginning of the year, we had that focus. We did, like, a goals. Like, you write down all your goals. And I think a lot of us were like, our goal is to win a state championship. Like, that's always the goal. But I think that year in particular, it was more realistic for us because we had been together so long and we had built that team bonding and that chemistry and we knew how each other played and that kind of thing. And so it was just throughout the year, we just kept growing and growing and we found ways to weasel out of what looked like a loss. And we would, even if we were playing terrible, we could turn a game around just like that with how we play together and our heart and our hustle and how well we play defense and Coach Wall's crazy coaching scheme that he would pull out sometimes. I just remember one game in particular, we were playing in the third round at Smoky Mountain and we were down the entire game. We didn't lead until 30 seconds left in the game.
Oh my goodness.
It was insane. It was the craziest game I think I've ever played in. No one was playing good because most of us had taken the ACT that day. So we were all so tired. And then we got on the bus and had to drive 4 hours. So that was another crazy thing about the day. And so something happened. We were playing a defensive zone trap thing. I don't know what Coach Wall calls it. But anyways, and someone stepped and step for a steal, and then I grabbed the ball out from behind her, and then we had a streak, and we went up on the lead, and then one girl on our team, Camry Gibbs, hit like 8 free throws in a row.
Wow.
Because she just kept getting fouled, kept getting to the line, and by gosh, we won the game by like 2 points, I think, but it was the most intense game I think I've ever played in. At the end of it, we still have a video of it. Coach Wall jumps up on our assistant coach and like wraps him up. It was so funny. Huh. It was great.
Yeah. I had the fortunate experience of being on campus the Friday morning before you left to go to the, in the process of leaving. Tell us about a particular moment I remember with the principal, Ms. Shepherd, and some, tell us about that morning.
Well, we were all kind of jumping in our seats, you know, when something's getting ready to happen and you, or like when you know it's gonna snow in school. You know, all the students are sitting there like, oh, we're gonna get out of school. And that was kind of us that day. We were like, oh, we're getting ready to leave to go to the state championship. And then all of a sudden, Miss Shepherd calls us out of class and we're like, what's going on? And so we come out of class and she was like, we're getting ready to parade you around the school. And we were like, what? And so Miss Shepherd just casually brought all the students out into the hallways and paraded us around the school and everybody was cheering for us. She just made us feel like queens of the world. Yeah. It was awesome. We got to go through the hallways. Everybody was cheering for us. People had made signs, and like they walked us out to the bus, and then everybody came out to the bus and was screaming. They like wrote on our bus windows. It was great. It was so cool.
How about the fellowship circle there in the Commons area? Tell us about how that must have felt.
It was great. That was before we started parading around the halls. Miss Shepherd told us what she was going to do, and she was like, okay, do you mind if I like pray with you guys? And we were like, yes, please. And so she prayed over us, and just felt so good. It felt right. Like it felt like we were supposed to win that state championship then. And I don't know, she's just she always has so much school spirit. She was at every single basketball game she could be at, every single football game she could be at. She was always there, and she just had so much school spirit. She made an effort to know every single person in the school, and it was just, she's a great person and a great principal, so.
A role model.
Yes, definitely, sure. Yeah. Definitely.
Such a spirit about Ms. Michelle Shepherd. I want to go to the academic side of your career, that being so important too. So tell us about being the top ranked student in your senior class.
It's definitely an honor, and lots of times I forget, but it's something that is just, I'll always have that. Like I'll always be able to say, you know, I was number one in my class. I'm not gonna go around and just tell everyone that, but at the same time, like it is something that I'm proud of, and it's something that I want for students younger than me. I'm like, ooh, you should like take all the hard classes, challenge yourself academically, like make an effort to try to do well, and that will pay off in the end. Like when you're trying to apply for colleges, like a number one definitely looks better than a number two or number three, for sure.
Sure.
But I mean, also, there's still a lot of pride in being anywhere in that top, that top tier of them. But definitely number one is the one to shoot for. Yeah.
Brooke Bentley is talking about being the top ranked student at Wilkes Central High School and the state champion basketball team of 2015. You played other sports. Share with us that opportunity, if you will.
I ran cross country in the fall, and I kind of got roped into that my freshman year. Our cross country coach knew that I was athletic, and he was like, why don't you come run regionals with us? And I was like, okay. And I was like, sure, why not? I don't have anything to do this Saturday besides a soccer game and some basketball games, so why not? I'll just go. And so I ran regionals, and I placed like fairly well. I ran like pretty fast for someone who hadn't been training. And so he was like, okay, well, I think we need to keep you on the team for next year. Like, you need to come out next year. And so I ran my sophomore and junior year, but my senior year, I was playing a lot of club basketball or club soccer, and it kind of didn't really work out that well. But my sophomore year, I was actually the second in the conference behind a girl from Elkin, and I was really sad. If I would have had like a 400 more meters, I probably could have beat her, but her legs were probably as long as my shoulders, so that was a little bit difficult. But I also played soccer, and I started on varsity for 4 years on the soccer team, and love those girls to death. I still love them, and we still have a group chat with all the soccer team from last year, and they're just great, great people, great players, and I love playing with them too.
Brooke Bentley, another highlight of your experience in Wilkes County schools would be that your mother was there and that she was a calculus teacher and you had her in class. Share that with us.
It was definitely a unique experience. I had her twice with probably around 20 people, and I had her in Math 3 Honors and then Calculus AB, and both of them there was like a pretty large class size. And so in class I tried not to say anything and like try to stay away from her as much as possible, like, because what do you say, Mom, Miss Bentley? Like, it's awkward anyway you talk. So, you know, I kind of stayed to the background and like helped other people around me as much as possible. And I mean, it was pretty normal, I guess you could say.
Yeah.
But I also had her in Calculus BC, and it was only me and one other kid. So that was, but he was really nice, and both of us wanted to get our calculus over with so we didn't have to take it in college. So, but we were the only two that applied for, or that signed up for Calculus BC. So our principal was like, can't have a class with only two people. So my mom volunteered to teach us during her planning, which was so cool. Like she.
So she just created that opportunity for you.
Yeah, she just gave up her time that she had to plan during that period and said, you know what, I'm gonna teach you guys because this is gonna help you out. Like it's not gonna help me out, but it's gonna help you guys out, which was really, really cool. And it, she's just great.
Miss Ginger Bentley.
Yes.
What an honor to share her today with our audience. You grew up a Duke fan.
I did. And, I did.
Tell us about that journey of transitioning from being a Duke Blue Devil to being tickled to death to be at Chapel Hill.
Yeah, it's still a crazy experience that I share with people. Like at Carolina, I'm just like, yeah, I was a Duke fan. And people are like, what? Because I'm always at all the games and I love Carolina so much. I bleed Carolina blue now. But at the time, well, it's crazy to think that this was just last year. But last year, you know, I was like, I'm going to go to Duke. I'll never go to Carolina. Like, that's not going to happen. Whatever. But I ended up applying for Carolina because of I was involved in the Moorhead Scholarship.
Tell us about that.
So I got nominated for our high school, and I was like, I might as well apply. I mean, you know, can't hurt, I guess. So I applied, and I made the semifinals. And I was like, okay, well, I mean, I can go interview for this. Why not? I mean, it can't hurt. So I went to interview for it and found out that I was a finalist. And I was like, all right, this is getting real. Like, it's pretty crazy. And so for the finals weekend, we got to go down to Chapel Hill. They kept us at the Carolina Inn, so they pampered us. We got all the cookies we wanted all weekend, so that was good. So we got to go to some classes at Carolina. We got to walk around campus, and then they interviewed us again. And unfortunately, I didn't get the scholarship, but I think it honestly was better that I didn't get the scholarship, because if I got it, I think my parents would have been like, you have to go to Carolina because you got the scholarship.
Right.
You have to go.
Right.
So by not getting that scholarship, A, it was very humbling to me, and B, I was able to make that decision on my own. Like, I was able to say, okay, let me weigh out my options and then decide which one I wanted and which one was best for me and which one was God's plan for me, rather than I got the scholarship, so I have to go here. And then probably coming into it thinking, oh, I have to be here, rather than I want to be here and this is where I'm supposed to be kind of
great.
Thing. Yeah.
Wow. Tell us about being at a basketball game at the Smith Center.
Man, the first time I was in the Smith Center was when we played in the state championship. And I just remember walking in, because we were the first game. And I remember walking in before any of the fans or cheerleaders or anybody was in there. And it was just a sea of blue, just blue, Carolina blue, all you can look. And I was like, I walked in and I was still a Duke fan. So I was like, this is disgusting. But now, I mean, it's crazy to think that like my first basketball game was when we played Tennessee this year. And I was on the second row of the risers right behind the basket. We waited, I think, 5 hours to
now
get
there. Now, what's a riser?
The risers are, it's 400 students like piled on some stacks behind the basket. And it's so fun. It's so fun. I've been on the risers.
The risers.
The risers.
Okay.
I've been on the risers for all of the basketball games that I've gone to. So you're right there behind the basket. You can see the players right in front of you. The basket's right there. Like, lots of times people will dive into the risers. It's crazy. But it's just, the atmosphere is insane. It just blows me away every time I come in, and it's just like this overwhelming sense of pride
for
Carolina.
The ticket process. Tell us about that.
Oh, yeah. So you have to apply for the lottery if you want to.
Every game.
Every game. Every game. If you want to go to the game, you apply for the lottery. And so fortunately this year I've got a lot of tickets, but they split it up phase one, phase two, and phase three. There's three phases for every game but the Duke game. The Duke game, there's five phases. But anyways, so if you get phase one, you get let in like an hour and a half beforehand. Phase two is like an hour beforehand, and phase three is like 30 minutes beforehand. But if you get phase one, you definitely want to try to get on the risers because you're just right there at the, I mean, it's just a great experience to be right there on the court. It's crazy because you're like, I go to school with these people. Like, this is so cool.
All right, let's go to the academic side and share with our audience today what it's like to be in a class. Just give us an idea of your most maybe interesting class so far as a student at Chapel Hill.
There's definitely a wide variety of classes. I've been in classes of 450 people, and I've been in classes of 10 or 20 people. But I think my favorite class so far has been a service learning class I took last semester. And it was biology and the cellular components of community blood donations. Which is, it sounds kind of crazy to think about, but in the class, so it was only 2 hours a week on Mondays. So we just went in Monday from 11 to 1. And we had lecture for an hour, and then the last hour was more service-based slash basically just service. So our class was partnered with the UNC Cancer Hospital and the Platelet Donation Center at the Cancer Hospital,
wow.
Which was really, really neat. It was probably like a 5 or 10 minute walk from class to the donation center. So we would lecture for the first half. In some classes, we would walk over to the donation center and we would just, you know, volunteer there, help out a little bit. But it was really cool because we learned about diseases that would require platelets to have. And we learned about blood typing and we learned about platelets and all the things necessary to understand how to apply it to like mm-hmm. real life. Mm-hmm. And it was really cool because it was automatic. It was like you learned it and then you immediately applied it because we were out there.
Oh, wow.
Yeah, it was really, really cool. And so through that class, we got to like get people to come donate platelets. I got to donate platelets a few times, which was really cool. And I'd never donated blood before, so I was kind of scared.
Yeah.
But it's actually a lot easier than whole blood donation, which is really neat. So I'm doing that a lot. And okay. But yeah, it was just a really neat class. It was really neat.
Brooke Bentley, you aspire to be a doctor.
Yes.
And yet, I'm sure that you're pre-med now. Just that choice you've made, tell us about that.
So I've always kind of been interested in medicine. And since I used to get hurt, well, I still kind of do, but I used to get hurt a lot more than I do now. So I was like, you know what? I'm going to be an orthopedic surgeon because I already know pretty much everything because I'm hurt all the time. Like I know pretty much everything. And so I basically knew that I wanted to do medicine, but I think through just like babysitting and working with kids and working in the nursery at church and stuff, has really helped me to realize that, you know, I also really want to work with kids. So I think right now I'm like considering being a pediatric oncologist just because like through that platelets class, I got to be around people with cancer who were getting platelets. And so like I know kind of what that looks like.
So that's a cancer doctor with
yes,
children,
yes.
Right?
Yeah. Okay. So it's kind of a tough profession, I guess.
Yes,
But I think that's something that I'm definitely called to. And so that's what I'm working towards at the moment.
We look forward to following your career and we know that you'll rise to the top. This would be a great opportunity if you talk about your senior project at Wilkes Central.
Yes. So I decided to do a Feeding Children Everywhere project, which is basically a company ships all this food to you, and it's lentils and rice and vegetables, and I think that's it. But you package it in plastic bags, and it's assembly line, so you put a bag under, and somebody dumps this, somebody dumps this, somebody dumps this, and then you pass it down the line, and you weigh it, and then you put it under the sealer, and you seal it, and then you put them in boxes. And so through my senior project, I had like 50 volunteers. We packaged 10,000 meals to send to Haiti, which was really, really 10,000 meals.
10,000?
Yes,
to
with
Haiti.
50 volunteers, yeah.
50 volunteers, okay.
Yeah. It was really cool. It was a very neat experience for all of us, I think.
Tell us about raising the money.
Raising the money is difficult. So the meals are, I think they're 25 cents a piece. I think. So I had to raise $2,500 in just for the meals, and then shipping was $1,000. So I had to raise a total of $3,500. And at first I was like, ah, that's gonna be fine. Like, I can probably do that. And then I was telling my parents about it because I'd planned it without really telling them. So I told my parents and they were like, are you kidding me? How are you gonna raise that much money? And I was like, oh, you're right, that's a lot. I hadn't really sunk in. I was just kind of like on high, like, I'm gonna do this. Like, this is so cool. I'm gonna have to do this. But so I ended up just sending out letters to a bunch of people in the community that I knew were very supportive of me, very supportive of community service, and all of that good stuff. And I had so, like, an overwhelming response, and just, you know, I prayed about it, and my parents prayed about it, and it just worked, itself out, and we ended up raising $4,400, which is crazy, and we just donated the rest back to the company.
So you set a lot of goals and work hard to make sure you get there.
Yes.
Let's talk about your family. I want to talk about your brother. He's also number one in his class.
Yeah.
So having high expectations in a family and how important that is to achieving, if you will.
Yeah. Our parents definitely expect a lot of us because they know what we are capable of, I guess. They are both extremely smart, and so they know what we can do, and they know that we've performed well in school, so they expect us to continue performing well. But honestly, the main thing with our parents is just they expect us to try hard, and they say, you know, as long as you try hard, we'll be happy, that kind of thing. But I just think, and they're also the most supportive people ever, and they are always there for us and, you know, always behind us no matter what. And I just think it's really cool that this is just a random thing, but to come back in the gym at Wilkes Central and to look up and see both me and my brother on the wall for state championships.
Sure.
Because he won the state championship in golf last year. Yeah. And so that was just like really cool. It was a thing for me, like, this past year. I walked in and I was like, oh, wow, we're both up there. Like, that's so cool.
Your church.
Yes. Here I go to Wilkesboro Baptist Church, and I have been a member there since I was like 7 or 8, I think, but I've gone there my whole life. Worked in the nursery there, always teach kindergarten Bible school, so like I love my kids at the church. I've got to see all of them grow up, which is so crazy. Like, some of them are like in middle school now, and I'm like, how does this happen? Like, this is crazy. But I think it's really, really cool. Since I have been a member of my church for so long, the people that have kept me in the nursery when I was little, now I keep their kids in the nursery.
Right.
So, like, it comes full circle.
Good.
Like, that's so crazy for me to think about. Like, the kids that I'm keeping right now in the nursery could be watching my kids. Like, that's crazy. That's crazy. But in Chapel Hill, I go to Chapel Hill Bible Church, and I also work in the nursery there, which is really fun. It's definitely a different environment. There's a lot more diversity, I guess. There's some there's some kids, I teach a two-year-old class, so there's some kids that only speak Spanish, and there's some kids that only speak Chinese. And that's just crazy, because we have a translator in the room that has to like mediate between me and some of the kids, and I'm just like, wow, this is so cool. Like, it's just completely different, but also really awesome and a blessing.
Casual. The summer.
Yes.
And music. Put those together.
I have gone to Caswell. It's a Baptist youth camp since I was in seventh grade. And my sophomore year in high school, I was like, you know what? I think I want to do this. So I'd always played piano. And I was like, I'm going to pick up the guitar. So I just picked up the guitar and started teaching myself how to play the guitar my sophomore year in high school. And I auditioned, I auditioned to work at Caswell this past January, and like after my interviews and everything was over with, I was like, wow, this is crazy. I literally picked up the guitar and learned how to play the guitar for this job, and got the job, and so I'm going to be playing music on stage all summer in front of a bunch of youth and leading them in worship, and it's just going to be great. I'm really excited.
Brooke Bentley, we want to thank Wilkes Communications and River Street Productions and WIFM for this opportunity. What an exciting moments we've had together, and our audience, I'm sure, is going to be inspired by your enthusiasm and your spirit and your willingness to do your best. So close with us for a couple of minutes, a couple of maybe 15 seconds about how God's blessed you with opportunity and that you've worked hard.
I'm so blessed beyond measure with my parents, the circumstances I've been given, my school, my family, my friends. Everyone around me has just been so positive and encouraging. And I encourage, you know, anyone watching this or anyone listening in, that kind of thing, to just be a light, be encouraging, and be that person that your friends can come to and show God through you, because I think
show that's... Show God through you.
Yeah, shine that light and you will be rewarded.
Brooke Bentley, you shine a light for us. Thank you for being here today.
Thank you.
We hope you'll come back again.
Oh, yes.
God bless you.